Hi, I'm here with Ray Guillette today, and we're going to talk about his career in photography. Welcome, Ray.
Thanks, Bruce. I'm glad you're here. This should be fun.
It should be, yeah. So we're both members of the Stony Brook Camera Club, and it's the 50th year anniversary of the club. Ray, can you tell me a little bit, when did you get involved with the club, and how did you get involved?
I joined in 1980, so it was 40 years ago, and because of my dad. My dad was a great photographer. We were members of the Providence Camera Club at the time, and Dad came to me one time and he said, you know, I hear at Stony Brook is a pretty good club, and they're having a member show. They call it a salon, and that's what they called a member show. It was a yearly event. They invited the public, so we went to see it, and we were blown away at the great pictures and the audiovisual stuff. So we dropped Providence and joined Stony Brook, and that's how we got started.
So tell me a little bit about your dad. What type of photographer was he?
Dad was, he just loved photography. He was a printer, and his main job in printing was to make catalogs of jewelry companies. We had a lot of jewelry companies in Attleboro at the time, Swank, Balfour, a lot of religious jewelry companies, Jeweled Cross, for instance. And so he would take pictures of whatever they made and make a catalog out of it. But he also was really interested in photography, I think mainly to document his family. He was a great family man, and he took pictures all the time of us kids and our kids' kids and our cousins and it was a family affair. But we both kind of got into camera clubs at the same time and into competition photography. Dad had what I call the Cadillac of the wet dark room. He was a black and white and a color print producer, and he was great at it. He was an expert in the zone system. He took courses in that. And he also got very interested in color prints. Before anybody was making color prints at home, he was doing it. Mm-hmm. And he actually started the color print competition at Stony Brook. He started it and was the first chairman, and I was the second, and it goes on from there. And when I was a little kid, maybe 5 or 6 years old, and I always tell people, when I learned to behave myself in the dark room, he would bring up a stool and let me sit on the stool, and he'd take a blank piece of paper under a red safe light, put it into the developer, and all of a sudden a picture came up. And can you imagine a five-year-old seeing that? I mean, it just, wow, look at that. That's how it all started.
Yeah, that's a very familiar story. My dad was a photographer as well, and I remember the exact same story. He took me into the dark room and he says, I'm going to show you some magic. There's going to be a picture that appears from this white piece of paper. Yeah. And I go, no way.
It is magic. There's no question about it. Yeah. Yeah. So we joined Stony Brook in 1980 and went on from there. It turns out it was one of the best decisions I ever made in my life was to join Stony Brook Camera Club.
Sure. And you have some pictures that you're going to share. You want to show that first picture? Is that
sure? This is not a picture I took, or that my dad took, but this is my parents, taken in 1932, and it does have a very strong Stony Brook connection. My parents were at an engagement party for my mother's one of my mother's friends. They worked together at the Attleboro newspaper, and my parents were engaged at the time. And the gentleman who was marrying this person that who was getting engaged to took some pictures. And it turned out he ended up being the science teacher for Dot Perrin, who was one of my great influences at Stony Brook. What a wonderful person. We call her the heart and soul of Stony Brook. So she's long since gone, sadly. But then he moved, this gentleman, his name is Al Weber, moved to Delaware. And at one point I happened to have a show in Delaware. I was judging down there, and they wanted me to put on a show. So I did, and Dot called down to her old teacher and said, hey, there's this guy Ray Guillette coming down from my camera club. So one thing led to another, and we were out at dinner down in Delaware, and he said, Ray, I've got something for you. And he gave me this picture of my parents. And this is in the 80s, and this is taken 50 years before that.
Wow.
So, and the wonderful thing about it is that it showed my parents in their youth. At this point in the 80s, my mom was getting kind of frail, and so it was really overwhelming to see a beautiful picture like this. So just out of nowhere, this guy comes up, gives me this picture of my parents, and I just totally blew me away.
What a great memory.
It was a wonderful moment. So yeah. Mom and Dad, especially Dad. Dad was he's always getting new cameras.
Mm-hmm.
I always got his previous camera to use. I've got one here. This is a Zeiss Icon Contessa. It's basically a point and shoot, but I used it in high school. It was just many years ago, to shoot football games and so forth, and I thought I was really hot stuff with that. And then the last hand-me-down was this Leica Flex, which Dad bought at the Leica factory in Germany on a trip that they were taking. And so when he graduated or got tired of it, then I got it. So, but now I use Olympus.
Yeah, for everybody that's watching, these are old film cameras back in the day. Absolutely. There was no such thing as digital.
No, these are all film. Dad's whole photography career was in film.
Mm-hmm. And you still enjoy shooting film, don't you?
I love film. And it's a long, not a long story, but a little convoluted story. However, I just love film. And I love the fact that you take a picture and you're done. You don't have to do anything else, but you have to do all the work before you push that button to make a good image.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, that is enough to keep me happy. And I do have a film camera. I have an iPhone, of course, and I have a digital Olympus camera that I use. But I'll be honest with you, I still prefer film just because of its simplicity.
So in the digital world, Ray, a lot of people now use Photoshop and Lightroom and other editing applications
mm-hmm.
to post-produce their films,
mm-hmm.
unlike journalism, where you take the picture right in the camera and that's what it is, because that's journalism.
Right.
In the film days, as you mentioned, you have to do all your setting and creating that image in camera.
Right.
But you've taken it to slightly a different level where you can do some post-processing in kind of a unique way. You mentioned that you do some shows. Can you touch on that a little bit, on how you show your images during a show?
I usually have two or three projectors,
mm-hmm.
and I have a dissolve unit, which is it's a very simple digital software that allows me to bring out a picture from a chosen projector when I want it, and then maybe blend it into another one.
Mm-hmm.
I do what I call montaging, both before and after the projection. And one before is to take two images which are underexposed,
mm-hmm.
put them together, and it makes one image that's correctly exposed. And sometimes I'll do it where I make a sharp image and I'll montage it with a fuzzy image of the same thing, and you'll get kind of a dreamy look to it. And other times, I'll do all kinds of crazy stuff. I've got a couple of things I can show you here. But it's just fun. And again, once I click that button, I'm pretty much done. I'll also do montaging on the screen,
mm-hmm.
where I'll put a picture up, say a picture of an interior with a lot of dark spaces, and then I'll project a second image from a second or sometimes a third projector that fills in the dark spaces with usually color.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the kinds. So, you know, you're not totally done when you press the button, but it depends on what you want to do with
and how you
image.
Show it. And you mentioned that you have this technique during your shows. Can you talk a little bit about where you do show your images?
Well, where I have shown them. There's not a big demand for digital show, for film shows at this point. I've been lucky enough to do 19 shows at the New England Camera Club Council conference at UMass in July. We've been doing this for 74 years, doing the conference, and it's grown into a wonderful thing where we get people from all over the country, the best photographers, pros and otherwise, and so I was fortunate enough to do 19 shows there. Some of them were instructional, some of them were just what I call audiovisual, showcases with slides put to music. So.
And you've done a number of shows elsewhere as well.
Yeah, I've taken these same shows to different camera clubs in the New England area, even as far as Hollywood, Florida, Niagara Falls, Chicago. So,
you've been all over the place.
Yeah, so that's a challenge, taking all your equipment in the plane, but whatever.
And you've even had a few write-ups in a local photography magazine.
Mainly the New England Camera Club Council Bulletin, comes out two or three times a year. I've also been was lucky enough to get into popular photography. I had an article with images in February of 2007, and this came about when I was at a PSA International. PSA is Photographic Society of America. Every year they hold an international conference somewhere, usually in the U.S. And in 2006 they held it in Baltimore. So I was down in Baltimore. I did a show, and I have a sequence where I took graffiti images, and so I took my two images, reversed them, and put them together like that. And then sometimes I would do this to it. So and just so happened that the senior editor of Popular Photography was in the audience. You know, I had no idea, and he never didn't come up to me afterwards. But I got a letter in the mail at my office about a week later, which I thought was a hoax. Must have been, this is somebody's playing a big joke on me. It says, "We would like to put you in Popular Photography." I said, "Yeah, right." So, but it happened, and I had an image. I had about three pages in Popular Photography. Yeah,
very cool.
Yeah, it was fun. That was exciting.
So you have a few more images on the couch there. I'd like to share some of those.
Sure. Okay. This one I took basically right down the street. This also has a Stony Brook connection. We had a field trip out to Dame Farm, which is an old farm in Smithfield, Rhode Island. Ken Wiedemann was with me, and he picked up this leaf, and he said, "Ray, look at this leaf. You might want to photograph this," because you know that I had. So I did. I brought it home. I put it into my biggest book, which was Gray's Anatomy at the time. I flattened it out overnight, so it was totally flat. And it had to be flat because there's very little depth of field. So I got up the next morning and went into a field down the street. It was a lot of mist and dew on the grass, and I laid down on the grass. We call it wet belly photography, and I took this picture with my macro lens wide open. And the reason I wanted it wide open is I wanted all these little circles to be perfect circles, because if you close down the lens, they would take on the shape of the aperture of the lens itself. So that's how. So this is backlit, and no post processing on that. So I did that one.
Very cool image.
Yeah, it's fun. This one I took up in the Adirondacks in the morning at the side of a river, and it was beautiful foliage on the other side of the river, and the sun was hitting the foliage but was not hitting the river. So I was able to get these nice reflections in there. So again, this is with a telephoto lens, probably about 100 millimeter, 100 to 150. And as fast as I could. No polarizer used on this because you don't want to eliminate that reflection in the water. So the gold is all reflection in the water from the leaves on the other side of the river.
Very creative.
That one, that was fun. I did a lot of indoor, what I call indoor flower photography, right downstairs in this house. And I do it in the afternoon because we've got a west window, so we've got beautiful light coming in all afternoon. And I put down a piece of Mylar, which is basically a thick aluminum foil, and to get that reflection. And I shot it with reflectors. So there's no light directly on the flower, but it comes in, and I have a reflector here, and it bounces off my reflector and onto the flower. So that's a lot of fun. I did this for years and years.
Very nice.
That was a lot of fun. This is Mount Katahdin up in Baxter State Park up in Maine. I think my favorite place in the whole world is Mount Katahdin. It's the upper end of the Appalachian Trail. And I took this from Tracy Pond. If you can see the slope coming up here, this is the last 5 miles of the Appalachian Trail. And the summit, of course, is up here. And I've climbed it many times until it got to be too hard for me. And now I don't climb it anymore, but I've got some pictures to remind me.
What a great sky though, as well.
Yeah, we were lucky to get a good sky that day. So that was fun. I like to go to the Boston Marathon every year, and I position myself at the very top of Heartbreak Hill, and I shoot, this is with a 50 millimeter lens, wide open, and I just pan along as the runners go by, and so all the people on the other side of the street get blurred out, and you get a nice even background. So that's what I do with that. So that's probably about a 1 second, anywhere from a half to a 1 second exposure.
And that's all in camera?
All in camera, yeah.
Yep. Very cool.
This is a lot of fun. That's really a fun thing to do. And, okay, here we go. I also love the Adirondacks. That's where I hike and climb nowadays because the mountains are smaller. At least some of them are. This is from Mount Joe, and I've climbed it, probably a couple dozen times. But this particular day, there was a couple up there, and they were engaged and just about to be married. And so they asked me if I would take a picture of them. So I did, and I sent them a copy of the picture, and turned out to be, a nice picture. So this is Mount Algonquin in the background, and Heart Lake is the lake in the foreground. So.
And you get some of that, the light streaming from the sky
down
to
on the, the light streams, yeah. So, yeah. It's a fun place. It's an easy climb. It's a little over a mile. And this one takes a little bit of explaining. I hope you don't mind. But this is one of my abstracts. I was heavily influenced by a Stony Brook member by the name of Dave Hughes. We became great friends. We went out shooting a lot. I'll tell you more about Dave later if we have the time. But he influenced me to really think in the abstract and think about design and color, and not really what we were looking at, but what the color and the design was doing. So, and he also inspired me to be more creative. So the way I took this picture, this is what you're looking at is a piece of glass. It's a castaway from the glass blowing laboratory at Rhode Island School of Design. So I went in there after the laboratory was closed, and I went searching around in the barrel where they threw their rejects, and burned my hand, of course. but I got several of these little pieces of glass, and when I mean little, they're maybe about that big, seriously. And I shot it at 8 to 10 times lifetime with a bellows and a macro lens, and I put a colored background in back of it. I had these colored background that I would paint myself, or it's usually something I made myself. And because if you move the background, the whole color scheme changes. So it's a lot of fun. So I took that, and then it was a slide. This was maybe 15 years ago. There was a place in Providence, a lab, where you could bring them a slide, and they would make, they had what they called a Canon laser copier. Mm. And you could make a print from that slide, which I did, but it was a paper print. It wasn't glossy. So then, to finish it off, I took fluorescent paint and kind of sprinkled it like that onto the thing. So, you know, it's either you like it or you don't. I happen to like it.
Yeah, it's very interesting, actually.
Was lucky enough to get a 30 on this at Camera Club.
Which is the highest score in the rating system we have.
Yeah, I know. I don't know why, but I did. But
very nice.
It was fun. So there we go. Those are my prints.
So after sharing some of those pictures, Ray, very interesting, great work. Can you tell me a little bit about, in your opinion, it's just a question, it's a thought that I kind of ponder from time to time, because we're all photographers now. We all have the smartphones in our pocket, and they all have amazing cameras in it, so we all think that we're photographers. But in your opinion, what do you think the difference is between creating an image as a photographer and taking a snapshot?
I think it's the pre-exposure work that you do, the work of looking and seeing, the work of making sure all your settings, multiple settings now on cameras, make sure that's all correct, and looking for the best light at the best time of day, and most importantly is viewpoint. You have to decide, do I want to be here or here? And sometimes just a couple of feet can make a big difference. Or do I want to be here or here? You know, high or low. So all those things, you know, that's the part of photography that I love.
And that's the part of the creative process, that the more images or pictures or snapshots that you take, you start to develop that creative eye, and you start to look at things a little bit differently. Yep. And the next time you go out, you know, maybe your photo taking, your image creation is just a little bit better.
Thank you.
Yeah, perfect. Fun. I love that answer. It's a question I always like to ask, because people have very different answers to it.
Yeah.
And I know that you do some judging. You mentioned some competitions that we have. You got a 30 on that one of those pictures that you showed us. Can you tell us a little bit about judging and your involvement with that?
Well, in camera clubs in this area, if you do well and you know, you win some awards, you become a judge, because the word gets around and other camera clubs will call and say, hey, would you come and judge for me? So I've done that a lot, and that's a lot of fun too, because then you get to try to help other people, try to first of all tell them what they've done right, what you really love about their images, and most importantly, is there a way you could change it and make it look better?
Mm-hmm.
So that's been fun. You know, I talk about impact, and first, usually impact, you know, what makes you look at it and say, oh boy, makes you look twice. So there's a lot of things that...
And that falls into play, like you talked about, just the changing of the angle of that photograph, mm-hmm. and the composition of that photograph can give it just that more or less impact of the same picture.
Exactly.
Yeah. Very cool.
Yeah, it's fun.
Now, Ray, I know you're not a professional photographer. Well, using professional photographer or hobbyist photographer is a kind of a catch-22 a little bit, but did you put food on the table with your photography, or how did you do that?
We would have starved if I did that. No, from the beginning, photography was fun. It was fun. I mean, let's face it, that's what I was out for. I'm a physician, a pediatrician, retired for 2 years, but I worked for 46 years as a pediatrician, and I loved it. I love working with kids. It's a privilege to do that. And yet it takes its toll in terms of I don't know how to say it. Just because you're responsible a lot for a whole lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I found that photography, especially with my dad in the beginning, was a great way to kind of get away from that and direct my energy into, because you expend a lot of energy in that type of work.
Sure.
And direct my energy in another direction, and that turned out to be creative and fun at the same time.
So. Yeah. Not only your physical energy, what I like about it as well, I mean, I agree with everything you say, but it's a mental diversion as well. It takes your mind, because when you're actually creating an image in manual mode on these DSLR cameras, you're giving it a lot of thought on what type of composition you're trying to create and what do I need to do to the camera to help me get there.
Very, very nice. Yeah, it's a great way to get away from it all, and to do something constructive, and to find that you have talents other than what you do for work is kind of neat.
So Ray, part of the going back to the Stony Brook Camera Club, can you tell me if I had to ask you one question, how would you answer this? How did the club? What was the most impactful part of the club to you?
Mm-hmm. That's easy. Meeting the people there. I've met some fantastic people at Stony Brook. I mean, we're all photographers. We're all creative. But even more important than that, we're all looking out for each other. There's a great tradition of sharing at Stony Brook. I think most camera clubs, but I think at Stony Brook more than others. From the minute I joined, there were certain people like Dot and Russ Perrin. They've gone, they've passed away, but they were just fantastic people. And they made sure that after every competition, they would come up to me and say, you know, I really like what this is. You know, the judge has said one thing. They'll come up and give me their take on it. It was usually positive. But then Russ would say, you know, next time you do that, why don't you try this? And he was always right. So I mean, I learned a lot, but also I had people supporting me. So Dot and Russ Perrin, number one. I also met probably some of my very best friends, not probably, definitely, some of the best friends I'll ever have in my life. They all come from photography, not from medicine. for instance, Dave Hughes. Dave Hughes passed away in 1995. He was, without a doubt, the most creative person I have ever met. And it's, he worked in slides. This was before the digital era, and everybody used to say, oh, I would love to see what Dave would have done with digital, but he did it all with photography. He was a master of multiple exposures. He had no rules. He made the rules, and he made his images according to his rules, and they were different, they were beautiful, and they were shocking. So he was great, and we'd go out together. And we'd talk about color, we'd talk about abstracts, design. You know, we didn't talk about, let's find a red barn. We just, he could take a bush and spend a couple of rolls on that bush and come out with some fantastic stuff. Mm-hmm. So he was a great person to be with. We had a lot of photo outings. The sad part about Dave Hughes is that he died too young. He died at age 53.
Wow.
Had a heart attack at age 50. He produced six showcases at the New England Camera Club Council. And he died in 1995, just 3 weeks before his last showcase was to be shown at the NECCC conference. So Roy Marshall, who's also a founding member of Stony Brook, and I got together. Roy put the end of his show, the show wasn't finished, but it was on the light table. So he put it together because he knew Dave well. And the two of us showed it at the NECCC conference. And I got a chance to introduce him and tell the world just what I thought about him. Mm-hmm. It was great.
What a privilege.
And that's the show we took to Chicago, Roy and I did. He really got me to look in the abstract world. Mm-hmm. So, there was a couple other members. I haven't mentioned John Fuller, who was a founding member. John was sort of the guiding light of Stony Brook in the early years. He always had the best interests of the club and the members in his heart. And so he was just a wonderful person. He kind of you know, steered us in the right direction. Bob Yankee, who was a founding member, Bob was the he, among other things, he was the program director at the New England Camera Club Council. And when I put my first show on, you put it on in the auditorium, there's 300 people there. I was scared stiff. You know, I just didn't know what to do. Bob came over, took me aside and said, look, we're gonna do this. And he helped me all the way along. I couldn't have done it without Bob. So, and Bob's founder of Stony Brook. So that's the kind of friendship that you get at Stony Brook. Gene Burke has also passed away, again, too young. She was, well, she was in her 60s, but she was a school teacher in Natick. She was a world traveler, and she loved children. She was a first grade teacher, so she did shows on Ireland, anywhere you can think of, Italy, all around the world, the Galapagos Islands, Antarctica. So she did shows on that, and she was just a fun person to be with. We, you know, you always ended up smiling after you were with Jean for a while. And after she died, I asked for her slides. I said, can I have Jean's slides? And they gave them to me. A friend, she had no family. A friend of hers gave them to me, and I made up a showcase just as a tribute to her, and I showed that the next year, the year after she died. And so, you know, but she was just a person who made you smile. She was just a lot of fun. She also brought you down, if you thought you were on a high level, she brought you down to reality, but in a nice way. Lucille Maynard. Lucille Maynard died about a year ago, well, less than a year. She's from Fall River. She's just a wonderful person. We used to call each other buddies. And she was she was a great photographer, but she was just a great person. Her husband died early in life and left her with two disabled boys who are now adults. And she took them right through. She overcame that. She overcame heart attack, breast cancer, and she still managed to be active in photography and go on photography tours to Arizona and places like that. So you looked at her, and it was an inspiration. You figured, well, if she can do that, sure. I guess I can do it. So she was just a fun person to be with. And I can't stop mentioning people without mentioning Andre Bork. Andre is now my buddy. We are buddies for life, best friends. And we have so much fun when we go out together. It's usually just he and I. And we don't stop talking. It's not our hands and feet that get tired at the end of the day. It's our voices. and by the time we finish the day, we've solved all the world's problems. Unfortunately, nobody listens to us. But that's the kind of friend he is. He's also a great photographer, fantastic photographer. He's taught me a lot. So, you know, it's people like that, starting with my dad all the way up to Andre, present day, who have just been such a big positive force in my life. Thank you, Stony Brook. So.
Well, Ray, I want to say thank you for spending a few moments with us, talking about your career in photography and in your life and the friendship that you made along the way with people at Stony Brook and beyond. So. It was a great pleasure listening to your stories. And
thank you, Bruce.
It's been a pleasure. And I hope you at home enjoy Ray's stories, and we'll talk to you again soon. Thanks again, Ray.
Thank you for the opportunity.